Thank you to CuriosityStream for supporting PBS. What if there is no such thing as dark matter? What if our understanding of gravity is just wrong? New work is taking another shot at that Einstein guy. Let's see if we finally scored a hit. We've now been searching for dark matter for over half a century. In the early 60s, Vera Rubin proved that the spiral galaxies are rotating so fast that they should fling themselves apart, assuming that they're held together by the gravity of the visible mass alone. They would need at least five times as much matter to provide the gravity needed to hold these galaxies together. And the gravity of visible matter is also way too weak to hold galaxy clusters together, or to bend the path of light to the degree seen in gravitational lenses, when more distant light sources are warped by an intervening mass. It sure looks like 80% of the mass in the universe is completely invisible to us. We've dubbed this hypothetical stuff dark matter, and of course we've talked about dark matter many times on this channel, from the evidence for its existence to some of the speculative ideas of what it might be made of, from exotic particles to black holes. But what if we've been thinking about this the wrong way all the time? The expected rotation rates of galaxies come from applying our laws of gravity based on the observed mass. So the mass could be wrong, or the laws of gravity could be wrong. After all, if your scientific theory doesn't fit observations, we should reject our theory, right? And for nearly as long as astronomers have been hunting for dark matter, others have been hunting for an alteration to our theory of gravity that can explain the effect of dark matter without the actual matter. Today, we're going to look into that long history, what has worked and what has utterly failed, and finally at a new proposal that purports to fix those failures once and for all. According to Isaac Newton's law of universal gravitation, the gravitational field drops off with the square of distance from the mass producing that gravity. In most galaxies, stars are somewhat concentrated towards the centers, which means gravity should weaken towards the outskirts. That means the orbital velocities of stars out there should be lower in order to keep them in orbit. The so-called rotation curve should drop. Orbital speed should diminish with distance from the center. Dark matter is supposed to add extra mass that's more evenly distributed through galaxies, strengthening the gravitational field in the outskirts to explain the high rotation speeds. Dark matter flattens rotation curves. But what if gravity doesn't obey Newton's law of gravity? Well, we actually know that it doesn't. Albert Einstein found that Newtonian gravity breaks down when the gravitational field gets too strong. There you need his general theory of relativity, which explains gravity as the curvature in the fabric of space and time, rather than just as a classical force. But Einsteinian gravity looks exactly like Newtonian gravity when gravitational fields get weak. But what if Einstein missed something? What if Newtonian gravity breaks down both for very strong and very weak fields? This is the idea behind Modified Newtonian Dynamics, or MOND, proposed by Israeli physicist Mordechai Milgram in 1982. The idea is straightforward enough. What if there exists a minimum possible acceleration that can be produced by the gravitational force? In MOND, force or acceleration drop off with distance squared until at very low values, they start to plateau out. This can be done with a modification to either Newton's law of universal gravitation, in which case gravity has a minimum strength, or by a modification to Newton's third law of motion, in which case the acceleration produced by a force has a minimum strength. If you tune the modification right, you recover the observed rotation curves for spiral galaxies very nicely without the need for extra mass. And you only need to tune a single parameter, which is effectively the minimum acceleration, to get the correct rotation curves for nearly all galaxies. That's very promising. But in order to be taken seriously, a new hypothesis, like MOND, needs to do a few things. 1. It needs to give the right answer in more than one special case. So MOND would need to do away with the need for physical dark matter in the other places we see evidence for dark matter. 2. It needs to be consistent with the other known laws and theories of physics that are experimentally verified. And 3. It needs to make testable predictions beyond the phenomena that it was tuned for. Let's take these one by one. First, how does MOND do with respect to the other evidence for dark matter? Not great, actually. If you tune MOND to work for galaxies and then apply it to galaxy clusters, you do get rid of the need for some of the dark matter, but not all of it. You still need about 20% of the current dark matter requirement to explain all the gravity we see in clusters. Now, you might think that cutting down the invisible mass requirements by 80% is pretty good, and it is helpful, to be honest, but the fact that you still need some type of physical dark matter in clusters is seen as a strong point against MOND in its first incarnation, at least. There are some other pieces of evidence for dark matter that OG MOND also fails for, but I'll come back to those. For now, point two. Is MOND consistent with the rest of physics? No, it is totally broken. It doesn't respect conservation of energy or momentum or angular momentum, and it's not consistent with general relativity in that general relativity does not reproduce MOND in what we call the weak field limit. Instead, it does what it was designed to do, it reproduces good old Newtonian gravity. It's not looking good for MOND, but let's address point three anyway. Does MOND make any predictions beyond the observations that inspired it? This is actually where we can turn this around. Spiral galaxies all follow this tight relationship between their speed of rotation and their luminosity. The brighter they are, the faster they spin. This is the Tully Fisher Law. It's a little surprising that the Tully Fisher Law is such a tight relationship because the rotation velocity depends on the dark matter halo while the luminosity depends on the stars. Now, those two are connected, but some believe that their connection shouldn't be so perfect to give the extremely tight Tully Fisher Law. On the other hand, if you tune MOND to get flat rotation curve spiral galaxies, you automatically get the correct relationship between rotation speed and luminosity. That was completely unexpected and an unengineered outcome of MOND. So while the Tully Fisher Law was already known, we can sort of count it as a prediction of MOND. And this one success has been enough to inspire others to dig deeper into the idea over the years. The next critical step was to get a version of MOND that didn't contradict so much of the rest of physics. For that, Jacob Bekenstein came to the rescue. Now, you may remember Bekenstein from such hit ideas as the Bekenstein bound, which connects black hole information content to its entropy, as well as other black hole related awesomeness. In 1984, he diverted his attention for a moment to work with Mordechai Milgram in fixing MOND. The first step was to reformulate MOND using Lagrangian mechanics. What on earth does that mean, you ask? Well, fortunately, we just did an episode on the awesome power of the Lagrangian. There we saw that the principle of least action allows equations of motion to be extracted in a way that automatically obeys all of our conservation laws. And done the right way, the result can also work with relativity. Bekenstein and Milgram achieved this by adding a second field to gravity. In Einstein's description, the gravitational field is what we call a tensor field, a multi-component object that describes the curvature of space-time. These guys added a new scalar field, a field that's just a single numerical value everywhere in space. And it was a good start. The resulting aqual for a quadratic Lagrangian gave the same result as MOND, except that conservation laws were obeyed. And because this was a relativistic theory, it was possible to see if it gave the right result for the bending of light by galaxies, which wasn't even possible with the original MOND. And it did not. Aqual also had the unfortunate prediction of faster-than-light waves in this added scalar field, which broke causality. Not to be deterred, Bekenstein came back over 20 years later with an update. If adding one field doesn't work, why not add another? In 2005, Bekenstein introduced TVS for tensor vector scalar gravity based on the fact that it describes gravity with three fields, a tensor, a vector, and a scalar. The introduction of the new field fixed the problem with gravitational lensing and also tamed the awkward causality-breaking nature of aqol. It acted like Newtonian mechanics on solar system scales, like MOND on galactic scales, and like regular general relativity for gravitational lensing. It was not without problems, though. For example, the physicist Michael Seifert claimed that Tevez and other MOND proposals produce instabilities in the presence of matter, which would, for example, make long-lived stars impossible. But the main problem with Tevez is cosmological in nature. One of the most important pieces of evidence for dark matter as a particle is seen in the light that comes from the very early universe. The cosmic microwave background radiation reveals a lumpiness that tells us how matter pulled itself together under its own gravity at the earliest times. Back then, light and matter were locked together due to their extreme densities. Regular matter was kept from collapsing into any structures by the pressure of the intense radiation of that era. But dark matter doesn't interact with light, so it would have been able to collapse just fine. And after the universe had expanded and cooled enough for regular matter to be released from the clutch of light, it could have followed the dark matter into its deep gravitational wells and get to the business of forming galaxies. But if dark matter isn't real and regular matter controls gravity completely, then no structure should have been able to form at those early times. For this reason, most forms of MOND, including Tevez, come up short. And this is where the new guys come in. In 2020, Konstantinos Skordas and Tom Zlosnik proposed a new relativistic version of MOND. And just last month, their paper passed peer review. Their big change was that they allowed the scalar field to change its behavior over time. They managed to tweak their equations so that in the early universe, the field behaved a bit like a type of matter, which Zlosnik calls dark dust. It was able to clump in the right way to kickstart cluster formation, but then later its behavior shifted so that it now behaves more like Bekenstein's Tevez proposal. More work is needed to see if the newly dubbed REL-MOND, relativistic MOND, works for galaxy clusters and keeps stars from exploding, but the authors are optimistic. Okay, so problem solved. We don't need dark matter anymore? Not so fast. Modified gravity theory still can't explain the bullet cluster. And I don't have time to get into that, and we've covered it before. So I'll just say that when two galaxy clusters collide and the dark matter gets ripped away from the light matter, it makes you doubt that dark matter is just light matter acting funny. Of course, there are MOND proposals which claim to address this, but the bullet cluster might be the most awkward result for modified gravity folks. At this point, the two theories are in a bloody theoretical knife fight, where the knife is Occam's razor. Proponents of dark matter as particle say that MOND proposals are now so elaborate and fine-tuned that we can't take them seriously. But MOND proponents say that it's the behavior of dark matter particles that have to be carefully fine-tuned to produce the phenomena that MOND predicts naturally, like the flatness of rotation curves and the Tully Fisher Law. Who's right? Well, the majority of experts are pretty firmly in the dark matter as particle camp. Although our experiments haven't detected dark matter yet, there are still plenty of possibilities for what it might be beyond our standard model of particle physics, and we've been through those before. But Bekenstein was no slouch, nor are many of the others who have supported MOND theories. We can't dismiss them out of hand. And personally, I withhold my judgment, because it's okay to be uncertain. And because it'll be equally exciting whichever way this gets resolved. One way or another, we open paths to continue our exploration of reality, whether we're led beyond the standard model by dark matter particles or beyond general relativity by hidden gravitational modes of space-time. A big thank you to CuriosityStream for supporting PBS. CuriosityStream is smart TV for your smart TV. The subscription streaming service offers documentaries and non-fiction titles from various filmmakers with topics including history, nature, science, food, technology, travel, and more. For instance, CuriosityStream has Black Holes, Messages from the Edge of the Universe, which examines not only black holes, but neutrino astronomy. It takes a deep dive into the science of black holes and takes you into the Antarctic lab where astrophysicists detected neutrinos in the ice of the South Pole. There are also collections of curated programs selected by experts. For more information, go to curiositystream.com/PBS Spacetime and use the code SPACETIME for a trial. Before we get to comments, we want to tell you about PBS's new medical show called Vitals. It's always been important to stay healthy, but it's gotten harder to tell what medical information is based on science and what is unhelpful pseudoscience. Fortunately, Vitals, PBS's brand new health and wellness show, is here to help. Co-hosts Dr. Alok Patel and nurse Sheena Williams will bust medical myths, explore the latest science, and answer all your burning health questions in every episode. Check out Vitals in the link in the description and tell them that Spacetime sent you. Our last episode was all about the principle of least action and how this one simple idea sort of leads to all of physics. Let's see what you had to say. Jay Smith asks, if the configuration space Lagrangian seems to bridge quantum mechanics and relativity, what's missing to make this a theory of everything? Rather than answer this myself, I will read the reply by Fernando, the co-writer of that episode. In simple terms, the universe at its very core seems to be a set of symmetries which are manifest in the Lagrangian. This means that if we knew all the symmetries the universe follows, we could describe it perfectly. But we don't know all the symmetries, and we're not sure how those symmetries fit with each other. Well put, Fernando. It's the symmetries of the Lagrangian, via Noether's theorem, that yields our conservation laws and, well, ultimately all of physics. Check our episodes on Noether's theorem, quantum invariance, and the electroweak force for some details. But we probably need to go even deeper. Jackie Johnson asks, in the case of gravitational lensing, isn't the light still traveling in a straight line? Isn't it space-time that bends, not the light? Well, that is a valid way to think of it. Light does travel in a straight line if you look at an infinitesimally small patch of space. Imagine light traveling through curved space as like an ant walking along a disco ball. The ant's path around the disco ball looks curved, even if it travels in perfectly straight lines across each mirror. Well, in space, the disco ball mirrors are infinitesimally small, but over those regions, the path is straight. A few people pointed out an error. I said that the action reduces to an integral over proper time in general relativity. That was right. But then I went on to call this a principle of least proper time by analogy to the principle of least action. In fact, in general relativity, objects in gravitational fields tend to maximize, not minimize, their proper time. That's still consistent with the whole action thing because the proper name for the principle is the principle of stationary action, and the maximum is also a stationary point of proper time and of the action. But I was still misleading, so thank you for correcting me on that. Many of you point out that you're already adherents of the principle of least action, as in you take the fastest, easiest, or laziest path to any outcome. Well, me too. Like, for example, the effort I put into coming up with a joke to end every comment section.